So hi everyone. In the previous lecture, we took some different amplifier configurations and we found out what are the different possibilities by which we can get a zero and how can we intuitively estimate zeros and poles of any MOS-based circuit. The same analysis will hold true even for a bipolar junction circuit. Okay. The only difference in a BJT circuit is you will have R-pi, which is not present in a MOSFET. From a small signal point of view, you can treat BJT and MOSFET as the same, except there is an addition of R-pi in a BJT. So most of the analysis that we do for a MOSFET will also be valid for a BJT as well, with some very small modifications. I'll briefly talk about it when we finish. I'll briefly talk about it when we finish our discussion on the MOS amplifiers. Okay, so I'll first quickly revise what we did in the previous lecture, and then I'll probably take some of your doubts, and then we'll go on to the physics of the MOS capacitor structure. So first, we spoke about the three architectures that is shown here. We took three examples, and we said that whenever you have, in the first two cases, we said whenever we have two different paths to the output. So for example, if you apply input voltage here, there is one path here to the output and the other path through the capacitance. And if both the paths have different frequency dependence, then you will end up having zeros in the system. Okay. And in the second case, also we took an example here. Here also we saw there were two paths to the output. So therefore, whenever you have two parallel paths adding together, and if both the paths have different frequency responses, then most likely you will end up having a zero in the system. Okay, so that's what we said. And the zero location can be found by equating the two path gains equal to zero, as sum of the two path gains equal to zero. Using that, we can get it. So what is the zero in the first circuit here? So in the first circuit, so if you're asked to find the zero here, so the current flowing through this capacitance should become exactly equal to this. So you can equate the current at this node, Kirchhoff's current law at this node. Under the condition of zero, the current flowing here will be zero. So what is the current flowing through the capacitor? If this current is zero, I can assume this node to be at AC ground. This node here is at AC ground. So I can say VI into SC, that's the current through the capacitor. At this node, the other current is GMVI is leaving out of this node, should be equal to GMVI. So from this, we got the zero location as plus GM by C, and this zero is a, what kind of a zero? Is it an LHP or RHP zero? This is an RHP zero, a right of plane pole, a right of plane zero. Now in the second case, we similarly analyze the circuit. Now if you see, again, when you're analyzing the zero, your input should be kept alive. Output is already gone to zero at that value of S. So I can assume V naught is zero. Now equate the two currents, the current through the capacitor and the MOSFET, they both are flowing into the node. The sum of the two currents, so here it will be GM VI plus SC into VI should be equal to zero. So from that you get the location of zero as minus GM by C. So in this circuit you get a left of plane zero, LHP zero. Okay, so that's where your zeros directly vanish to. I mean, this is the frequency value of S where your output vanishes to zero, even though input is present. Even if input is present, output should go to zero. The third condition, we took an interesting example, and then we said the third condition, we took an example where we had an impedance Z here, Z of S, okay? We had an impedance Z of S here, and then we had another load impedance ZL of S here. To find the impedance of find the poles and zeros in this circuit, we said that we'll calculate GM directly here. Now, if you see this circuit, there are no two explicit paths to the output. There are no two paths in the circuit to output, but still we actually got zero in the circuit. And we said that is the condition. For example, let's say your source node is floating at some frequency. If the source node is floating, if I apply VI, what will be the current in the circuit? Source node is floating. So the current will become zero, right? If the source is floating at that point, your current will become zero. So that's what is happening at some value of S. If this impedance tends to infinity, this node becomes an open circuit. And when that happens, there will be no current flowing in the circuit. So which means your current becomes zero, output voltage will also become zero. So therefore, that's a zero of a circuit. And look at this impedance. We discussed, if you have a parallel R and C, what is the frequency, what is the value of S at which the parallel impedance will blow up to infinity? So equate R equals minus 1 by SC. So you will get the location of the zero equals minus 1 by RC. This is a left of plane zero. So that's what happens here. Because this impedance is blowing up to infinity, we are getting a zero in the circuit. Is there any other possibility that you can think of a zero? We have considered two very important categories where we can get a zero. One, if you have two different paths to the output, you get zero. Okay, or you get zero when you have a condition like this, where this impedance blows up to infinity and the current becomes zero. So one of you are asking a question, is it equal to time constant for only first order system or for any system? What is equal to the location of zero? I mean, the point where the impedance blows up to infinity or? No, yeah, that's a very generic question. So let me, generally, if you take a first order system, let's say we have a circuit like this. So this is simply a voltage divider. You have a resistor here and an R and C here. If you have one capacitor, then the maximum order of the system can be one. Okay, if you have a capacitor in the system, generally you will have the order of the system will be at least one, equal to the number of capacitors. This is a first order system. So for a first order system, if you want to characterize a first order system, one of the most important parameters is time constant. If you know the time constant, you more or less know everything you need to know about the system. Okay, and one by that time constant will be equal to the pole in a first order system. In a first order system, 1 by tau will be equal to the pole. So this is an important thing to understand. If that's what you're asking, yes, if that's what it means. In the first order system, this condition holds true. But generally what happens is, in amplifiers, we will actually see something like this. We will see an RC, then an amplifier, then we will see some another RC this way. So let me call this R1C1, R2C2. So I can treat them as a cascade of two first order systems. This is one first order system, this is one first order system. So to individually find the poles, I can say omega P1 will be 1 by R1C1. This here I'm writing in radians per second. If you write SP, it will be minus of 1 by R1C1. Similarly, omega P2 will be 1 by R2C2. So I can treat them as two independent first order systems and cascade the two systems. So that's what we will be doing very soon now. When you have more than one capacitors, we'll do this. Yeah. Okay, so let me come back to that question, which is, we were looking at what are the different possibilities, cases where you can have zeros in a circuit. We took two examples and we found where zeros can exist. When you have two parallel paths to the output, you can have a zero. Then we also discussed a condition where if your impedance in a source degenerated MOS device blows up to infinity at some frequency, the source impedance blows up to infinity at some frequency, even then you can have a zero on the circuit. What is the third condition? Can you think of a third condition? So far, if you see in all these conditions, there is one common factor. That is, I'm trying to find out the short circuit transconductance being equal to zero. Right? The first example, short circuit transconductance goes to zero. Second example, short circuit transconductance goes to zero again. Third example as well, short circuit goes to zero. Yes. The other condition that we have missed out is, even a zero in Z out of S will also be a zero. That's something you have to keep in mind. Even a zero in Z out of S, the output impedance contains some zero, that will also be a zero of the transfer function. So then how do we get a zero in the output impedance? So for example, let me give you a circuit. So output impedance looks like this. If this is your output impedance, then can I say I'll have a zero here in the circuit? So what is the zero of the circuit? What is the frequency at which this impedance goes to zero? It will go to zero at R equals minus 1 by SC. This impedance becomes zero. So the pole of the point where the system will have a zero will be 1 by RC. So even if the impedance goes to zero, the output impedance goes to zero, that will also be your zero frequency. So from that condition, you can derive zero as well. Let me give a simpler example and you can try to find out. Z equal to zero is a condition for zero, right? If Z becomes zero, your output becomes zero, V naught becomes zero. So that's a condition for zero. Z equal to infinity is a condition for pole. Because that's the point, that's the condition under which your output goes to infinity. Transfer function blows up to infinity. Now let me give a small resistor circuit this way. You have R1 and R2C2. So this is R2C2. So now there are no other capacitances in the circuit. You've applied an input here. Output voltage is at this point. Can you tell me what will be the poles and zeros in the circuit? So what are poles and zeros in the circuit? Yes. So now there are two parallel branches. If any one branch goes to zero, if any one branch goes to zero, then the overall impedance also goes to zero. So there is a zero. So you know that what is it, left of plane or right of plane zero? So the zero is at minus. It's a left of plane zero. It will be minus of 1 by R2C2. Now what about a pole? Is there a pole in the circuit? Use the same condition. You have two parallel impedances. Can I simply equate R1 equals minus of R2 plus 1 by SC2? So exactly. So you'll get a pole, SP, a left of plane pole at minus of 1 by R1 plus R2 times C2. We use the same condition, equated this to a negative of the other impedance, and you get this condition for pole. So now you know pole, you know zero, you have one capacitor. So at max, you can have one pole and one zero. And we are seeing that it has both a pole and zero. We have found the transfer function now. So the transfer function for this impedance, I'm writing the transfer function for impedance Z out of S, will be 1 plus S R2 C2, because we know the zero, from that we can write this, divided by 1 plus S R1 plus R2 into C2. This is the pole. Now what is the DC value? Whenever you're writing a transfer function, you need to know its, to complete your transfer function, you need to know its DC value as well. What is its DC value? What is the value of this impedance at S equal to zero? When S equal to zero, think. When S equal to zero, what will be the impedance? DC value, impedance. I'm only asking about the impedance. DC value. R1 itself, right? If capacitor is open circuit, it will be just R1. So it will be just R1 itself. So that's it. This is your expression for the DC value of the impedance. Okay, this, if you multiply it by minus GM, you get the overall transfer function. This is your short circuit transconductance multiplied by the output impedance. So this is the overall expression for your voltage. Now we are seeing there is a zero, and the zero is coming because of a series RC network in the circuit. So this is other condition by which you can get a zero. Okay, so we can find some more complex structures where we can get a zero, but these are some simpler structures. Okay, so we have ignored R0 in all these cases. So I've already said that at the beginning of the lecture itself, R0 is always going to come in parallel with R1. You don't need to explicitly do the analysis. In all the analysis which I've done so far, I've assumed RL to be the load resistance at the output, and that RL will generally contain R0 as well. You can assume that RL contains R0 as well. Okay, it'll just come in parallel with R0 for common source at least. And for common drain as well. For common source and common drain, it works perfectly. For a common gate, the analysis becomes a little bit complicated, and I'll analyze it later. Yeah. Okay. So far we have analyzed common different MOS amplifier configurations with resistive and capacitive loads, and then we found different conditions under which we can find zeros and poles. Okay, so now just one point to complete our discussion on this. When we began our lectures, we were talking about discrete amplifiers. We said that whenever we are working with a discrete amplifier, we normally connect a capacitor, and this is your input resistance. We connect a coupling capacitor so that we can couple only the AC signals. And let's say you feed it to an amplifier with a gain A, and the output of this amplifier is again AC coupled using a capacitive load, RL. Okay, so it's AC coupled this way. So this is C. Let me call this CC and RL. Now, what kind of a transfer function is this? Is this a high pass or a low pass? So if I have a capacitance and a resistor this way, RN and C, if I ask you to draw the frequency response for this graph, can you draw the transfer function, the frequency response for this graph? Yeah. So we'll draw the frequency response for this function. What are the poles and zeros for this transfer function? So you just need to know two more functions. So we'll just derive that and start analyzing single stage amplifiers more rigorously. So what is the transfer function? I'll look at two kinds of transfer functions. One is this, R and C. In the other case, it's a capacitor and a resistor. Okay, so first let's look at the simpler circuit, which is this one, and then I'll come back to the circuit as well with capacitance of the input. In the simpler circuit, what will be the voltage? If this is Vi, V naught here, let's write the transfer function for this. If you're writing the transfer function for this circuit, does it have any poles in the circuit? Does it have any pole? No, this circuit, it's a one by, I mean, it's a direct RC circuit. Think about it. Are there any poles in the circuit? See, what is the definition of a pole? What is the definition of a pole? What is the definition of a pole? The definition of a pole is that at that value of S, your transfer function should blow up to infinity. Let me ask you this simple question. Let's say at some value of S, at some value of S, which is non-zero and non-infinity, at some value of S, if the current in the circuit becomes zero, sorry, if the current in the circuit becomes infinity, at some value of S, if the current in the circuit becomes infinity, then I'm going to multiply that current with the output impedance, which is 1 by SC. Can I say this will also be a blow up to infinity? Because your current is infinity at some value of some non-zero value of S. So at that non-zero value of S, 1 by SC will be finite. So a finite value multiplied by an infinite value, you will get infinity. So yes, maybe there is a pole in the circuit. When does this condition happen? Where for the current to be infinity, the impedance should be zero. The sum of the two impedances should be zero. So if R plus 1 by SC is the sum of the two impedances is zero, then you get the condition for pole where the current becomes infinity as no, a finite Vi can provide. See, for example, let me just say I have connected two impedances this way, R and C. A finite impedance, if the impedance becomes zero at some point, yes, it can. I mean, an ideal voltage source can deliver it. If it has a source resistance, then it can't deliver it. Yeah. But an ideal voltage source, in theory, can deliver an infinite current. Yeah. So your location of the value at which current becomes infinity is minus 1 by RC. At that frequency, the output is also finite. I mean, the output impedance, capacitance is also infinite, impedance is finite. At 1 by SRC, if you see, if you substitute S as minus 1 by RC, you will get it as minus R. Okay, minus R. So at that point, it is still finite. The impedance is still finite. So output voltage will blow up to infinity. In fact, I have just told you intuition to derive it, but this is a very simple circuit, so you can derive it in the brute force way itself. So it's a potential division, 1 by R by SC plus R by 1 by SC, you will get 1 by 1 plus SRC. That's the transfer function for this circuit. It's a single pole system. It's since there is one capacitor, the pole is at minus 1 by RC. Okay? And if I'm, it's a single pole system, so if I draw the Bode plot, it's going to look this way. After you encounter 1 by RC, the transfer function will just roll with a slope of minus 20 decibels per decade. Okay? And what about the phase response? What do you think will happen to the phase response? Phase response, the general procedure, see, Bode plot is more of a straight line approximation to an actual transfer function. But to a good degree, to a good extent, it gives you a very accurate result as compared to a rigorous analysis. Okay? So this is your Bode plot graph. If you're asked to draw the phase response, always, if 1 by RC is the phase, start from 1 by 10 RC. From 1 by 10 RC, I'm showing the phase on this curve. Your graph will start as a straight line. What will be the slope of this graph on the phase graph? What is the slope of this phase graph here? It's a phase plot. I'm plotting the phase response. What is the approximate slope of the phase graph? 45 degrees per decade, right? So at 1 by RC, it becomes minus 45 degrees. And at 1 by 10 by RC, it goes to 90. We can approximate it going to 90. So this is it's a straight line approximation with a slope of minus 45 degree per decade. So whenever you're drawing phase plot, keep that in mind. Start at the frequency of interest, where whether there is a pole or zero. Start the plot from a decade before, and the phase plot will end a decade after. That's it. Its influence is within two decades. A decade before the location of the pole are zero, and a decade after the location of pole are zero. And the slope of that graph will be minus 45 degrees per decade. That's the slope of the graph. So that's how you draw the phase response. So the maximum phase shift the single pole system can cause is 90 degrees, minus 90 degrees. Okay, so one of you're asking the question, isn't it a condition for zero? No, it's not necessarily a condition for zero. You have to analyze it circuit wise, okay? See, there are many ways of finding zeros in passive circuits. So I have taken only two examples because these are the two commonly encountered transfer functions in MOS circuits. So I'll only analyze this much. If you're interested, I'll probably recommend a video in one of my videos. I'll probably recommend you that you can watch that. Okay, there are much more complex structures in passive circuits where you can derive zeros and poles using different conditions. Okay, yeah. So now let's come back to this circuit. I'll first write the transfer function as it is by using voltage division. So you will get R by R plus 1 by SC. So you get SRC by 1 plus SRC. That's the transfer function. So what does it contain? I mean, does it contain a pole and zero? So it has a pole at DC. You have a zero at DC, SC equal to zero. And you have a pole at minus 1 by RC. This is a left of plane pole. So how will the frequency response plot look like? If I were to draw the frequency response of this graph here, how will the frequency response graph look like? So I'll show this on frequency axis. How will the frequency response? Where should I start? It'll start at minus infinity on a decibel graph. It'll start at minus infinity and it'll raise with a slope of plus 20 dB per decade. And after that, at what point will it become constant? Will it become constant? It has to encounter a pole. This is zero right now. It encounters a pole at 1 by RC. It encounters a pole. Pole will try to reduce this. Zero will try to increase this. So the net effect will be a constant. Okay? So this is the response you will see for this, for a function that looks like this. And what is the value of this one? The constant value, what is its value in decibels? What is its value? See, at very high frequencies, what happens? The one here, you can ignore the factor one here. 1 plus SRC becomes SRC. So you will get SRC by SRC. It will get cancelled out and you will get 1. So 1, 20 log 1 is 0 decibels. So this point will be 0 dB. Okay? This point will be 0 dB. You can see that from the circuit itself. Look at this circuit. At infinite frequencies, what happens to the capacitor? At infinite frequencies, what happens to the capacitor? It will act like a short circuit. So I can short circuit the capacitance. If I short circuit the capacitance in this circuit, what is the value at infinity? What is the decibel value in infinity? Or output voltage in infinity? At infinite frequencies, what is the output voltage in the circuit? 0 or minus infinity decibels. It will be minus infinity decibel or 0. Now what about this circuit? At infinite frequencies, if the capacitance is a short circuit, then what's your output voltage V0? Equals VI itself. So because V0 is equal to VI, the voltage, the gain at this frequency will be 1. The gain at this frequency will be exactly equal to 1. So that, which means it is 0 decibels. So that's what we are seeing here. Now, similarly, can you tell me what is the DC gain? At DC, at S equal to 0, capacitance acts like an open circuit. Okay, capacitance acts like an open circuit. So what will be your V0 in this case? In the first example, if capacitance is an open circuit, what is V0? VI itself, right? Because this is open, the current flowing through this is 0. If this current is 0, the entire VI will appear across at the output. So it is VI itself. What about this circuit? Capacitance is open circuit. So since capacitor is open, what will happen to this? What is the voltage across R here? 0, because there is no current through the resistance. If there is no current through the resistance, then the voltage across it will also be 0. The entire voltage will drop across the capacitor itself. Okay, so at DC, you will have VI dropping across the capacitor and there will be no voltage across the resistor. It will be 0. And that's what you are seeing. So at DC, you should see minus infinity, and at infinite frequencies, you should see a gain of plus 1, okay, or 0 dB. So here minus infinity is in decibels. The gain will be 0. So therefore, if you see here, this circuit, it is at lower frequencies, the gain is 1. At higher frequencies, the gain is 0. So therefore, you can say it's like a frequency selective network. It is permitting only lower frequencies and rejecting higher frequencies. Okay, so therefore, this I can say it has low pass. It passes lower frequencies. Therefore, this RC is a low pass filter. And this RC circuit with capacitor in between the input and output, at high frequencies, the gain is 1. At low frequencies, the gain is 0. So it's not passing lower frequency signals. So it's a frequency dependent gain. It's not passing lower frequencies, and it's only passing higher frequencies. So this is a high pass. So this is a high pass filter. Okay, so we'll see these two are very commonly used, at least in discrete time amplifier circuits, and sometimes even in IC design, I mean integrated circuits as well. Okay, so with this, we have discussed more or less the different RC configurations and MOS amplifier configurations that you will encounter in practice, and we saw how to find poles and zeros for